Before we get started, we need one nursery, one helper. Just one nursery, one helper. Ron Foster. One nursery, one helper. Send old Henry. Henry will keep them in line. I know that. One nursery, one helper. One and one. You need one and one? One nursery, one helper, one and one. All right. Ron Foster's rounding them up. Well, hey, I'll tell you what, you never know what an asset you got until you tell them, you know what, if you don't find any, I'm going to go back there and you're preaching, Ron. Ron said, I'll find them. I got them. Shoot, how y'all doing? Woo, it's this bunch right here. How y'all doing over there? Yeah, how about y'all over there? How about y'all in the middle? How are y'all doing? Still this group right here. All right, I'll take it. Man, it's exciting. What awesome, beautiful weather. This what I like right here. What I like right here. They're not my cows around the house, but the cool thing is you see, oh man, you get to see all these late summer, early spring calves, and man, it's just beautiful to watch, and you just get to see. Just to see all that has just been such a blessing. It's not just a beautiful time of year. It's just beautiful. And before we get started, I'm gonna do just a few announcements. Number one, we got Fall Fest coming up, and that's this next Saturday. This next Saturday is Fall Fest, and it's from 11 to 1. We need a couple of things. One, we need candy. You saw some candy out there, and again, it's Saturday. When's the Fall Fest? Which Saturday? So I don't give a whole lot of time. We're going to need some candy, lots of candy. And so probably just any time during the week. I know Miss Teresa will be here. Teresa, you going to be here this week? You can bring it by, drop it off, and we'll be happy to have that. The next thing we need is booths. So we got three that we have the games. We just need people to run them. But we need, I know the youth team signed up. I'm going to help them. And so I know that we'll have a booth. And it's as simple as this little old bowling game, just a, you know, little old ring pitch, you know, whatever you got. If you got something else you want to do right out of the back of your truck or SUV, then, man, y'all come on and do it. And don't think that we got plenty, because we don't. We only have youth team signed up. So we got one committed. And so we need your help with that. And it's always a fun time, and just get to interact with these kids. I know they're working on fire truck from Hallsville. Crutchfield, you got a contact for, got it? All right. So I know the fire truck will be here. The kids always like to go, and the big kids like me like to go and see in there. And maybe this year I'll get to wah, wah. What, you think that's? He didn't give me any acknowledgement at all. So that's this Saturday. Just plan on coming and helping, and that'll be a great time.
Sean.
How do they let you know?
If you don't get the candy here on mm-hmm. Wednesday or this week sometime, just bring it Saturday. Bring your body, mm-hmm. and we will put you to work.
Mm-hmm.
It's 2 hours
mm-hmm.
out of your life.
Yep.
11 to 1, and if you are going to do something, you might want to be here at like 10:30 to get everything set up. If it is, it's supposed to maybe be rainy. If it is, we're going to set it up on the porch, and you know, we don't want to say we're going to have it and then not have it.
Yeah.
So if you can just show up, we will put you to work.
It'll be
okay.
Fun.
And just remember, the blessings are going to be for you and for other people.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's the workers at the wedding of Cana got the greatest blessing. That's right. A facility team meeting right after church. Y'all going to meet right in that little serving area right there to the right. Facility team meeting right after. Also, November the 11th. So this is another event. We have, I guess, every year for several years, we have out at Sam Satterwhite's place, the Combat Warriors gather up. And now that Sam's gone, his family continues on this tradition. They gather up the Combat Warriors, and they take them on a deer hunt. We've been blessed for the last several years that we show up out there at Sam's place about 3 o'clock in the morning and we cook them breakfast. We bless them for blessing us. You know, they didn't have to serve this country. They didn't have to fight so that we could be free, but they did. They made a choice, and they're getting blessed with a hunt, and we want them to leave with a full belly knowing that we're thankful and appreciative of the sacrifice that they made. The one thing that they all have in common is that they're all combat warriors, and some of them, you'll see some that are, you know, that are missing limbs. They went to war and didn't come back with everything they left with. And we just love on them, bless them, feed them, and serve them, just be there for them. So if you want to help with that, you can you can get with any of us. You can get with Reuben. You can get with me. You can get with Dale and Mike that's in the back. And you just get with any of us, and we'll plan on we'll supply everything. All we got to do is just show up there at 3 o'clock. We'll even supply the address just to make sure you get there. And we'll cook and bless them. And that's November the 11th, November the 11th. And we need to know ahead of time. We're gonna be there anyway, so it'll be a good time. That's always fun. The one thing I'm going to miss, though, is Sam's stories. And that always just made it special. But it's still going to be special. Still be a good time. So y'all ready to see what God has for us today? Okay, that's most of you. I'll take it. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you and we praise you, Lord, for your presence that's with us today. We thank you for your spirit that's in this house. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for bringing us through what we've come through all the way to this day. Every one of us come in here with a different story. Every one of us has a story to tell of where we were and where you brought us from. And it's all about you. Every story of a resurrection story is all about you, Jesus. And thank you for being that resurrection in our life. Thank you for being the resurrection and the life. Thank you because you did it, we will someday. And God, I thank you for what you have planned for us today. I thank you, Lord, for this time that we set aside to worship you and to honor you and to give our time for you. God, I thank you that we've come this far, and I know, Lord, that you will inhabit the praise of your people as we begin to worship with this team that's prepared for us today to worship. God, we thank you and we praise you. Thank you. I can't say it enough, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for all you've done and all you continue to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, good morning. Good to see you all here. Thank you. It's good to be here. Good to be seen. No. Yeah, we do have everybody back, so it's great to have our team back together, and we're going to worship the Lord this morning, and we want you to stand and worship. If you want to clap your hands, if you want to stay in your seat, that's fine too, but you know, there's all kinds of ways to worship the Lord.
Glory. can of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an uncloudy day. Oh, the land of cloudless days. Oh, the land of an uncloudy sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm. Far away, where the tree of life in eternal blue sheds its fragrance through the uncloudy day. Oh, land of cloudless days. Where no storm cloud rise. Oh, they tell me of an uncloudy day. Oh, they tell me that he smiles on his children there, and his smile drives their sorrows away. And they tell me that no tears ever come. Oh, land of
This next song is called Today We're Gonna Praise You Again. You know, I've seen since I've been to church here already how many answered prayers there's already been in this church. And you know what? We always remember to pray, but sometimes, even me, I forget to give the credit to God and praise God for answered prayers. So let's praise God for such a wonderful church we got to come to today. And this is just an old rewrite song. Today I want to praise you again. It doesn't matter where I'm going or where I've been. Just as long as you are by my side to be my helping hand. Said today I wanna praise you again. What a fool I was to think I could get by without you, Lord, my Savior in my life. And I was all alone when Jesus heard my cry. So thank you, Lord, my soul will never die. Today I wanna praise you again. It don't matter where I'm going or where I've been. Just as long as you are by my side to be my helping hand. I said today I want to praise you again. Today I wanna praise you again. It doesn't matter where we're going or where we've been. Just as long as you are by our side to be our helping hand. I said today I wanna praise you again. Yes, I was all alone and Jesus heard my cry. So today I wanna praise you again.
All hope has faded.
the questions hit so hard, and though my soul may feel forsaken, you still reign and you're still God. Though I can't see what's before me, no.
Thank y'all for that. Yeah. I told elders and I, we gather up out there and pray right before right before I preach, and I told them, they said, "You good?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "I'm just not real sure what direction we're gonna go," and it's it's Sunday morning, and here we are. So, but that's okay. It's okay. I know the Lord's going to come through. I have a path. I have a plan, and we'll see if it turns out that way. That be all right? Okay, five of you. Thank you. All right, appreciate you. All right, let's go. Father God, I thank you and I praise you for the time that we have, Lord, that we've had to worship your holy name. And, oh, my goodness, you still reign, and you're still God. Thank you, Father, for being there for us, for all of us, through the toughest times of our life. Thank you that you have never failed us when things looked like they were falling apart. Lord, you had them all perfectly together in the palm of your hand, and you're going to see us through. And I thank you, Lord, that you were the God that was there with us through the tough times. You're the God that's there with us through the easy times. You're the God that's there with us in this time. And I thank you, Lord, that you've seen us through then. You're going to see us through still. You saw us through tougher times than this. You're going to see us through this tough time. God, we just thank you that we not put our focus on, Lord. Help us, Lord, not to spend more time watching the news than we do reading your word. God, we just thank you that every word of your word is true. I can't say that about all the news we watch. But Lord, I know your word is true. I thank you that your timetable is perfect, that your plan is being fulfilled. Lord, I just thank you for all you've done and continue to do. Thank you, Lord, for this time that we have now to break the bread of life together. Father, I pray that you reveal the hidden manna. Lead me, guide me, direct me, help me. Lord, I pray that you prepare our hearts to receive the seed of your word and that we chew on it, that we meditate it, that we take it with us, and that we share with others. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. There you go. Now, thank you for that. I could preach now. He do that every time, doesn't he? The one time he didn't, I missed it. All right, here we go. I got to thinking, and this question has come up a bunch of times. So with all the current events, and I won't get all deep into this because I'm a shallow-minded person. It ain't good when shallow-minded gets all deep into something. You tend to get flooded. You tend to get drowned. And so what I do want to talk about, though, is so many have said, what's next with this war going on with Israel? Israel is at war. If you haven't been praying for Israel, please pray for Israel. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Lift up that country. Lift up that nation. Also, the innocent Palestinians that are being used as shields by the coward Hamas that are hiding behind them to protect their missiles. Israel uses their missiles to protect their people. Hamas uses people to protect their missiles. And it's... I'm going to stop. Continue to pray. Continue to pray for them. So it's come up. Some of you are familiar with the Ezekiel 38-39 war. It's the Gog and Magog war. Some are familiar with that. And is that next? Is that what's going to happen next? Or is it going to be Jeremiah 49 where Iran is annihilated? Or what's next? What's next? And so I got to thinking about that. And the bunch that I listen to and the bunch that I subscribe to and that feed me, they confirm that there's nothing left, no prophecy left, as far as they know, that needs to be fulfilled before the rapture of the church. It can happen at any time. We don't have to be here for the Ezekiel 38 war. We don't have to be here for the Jeremiah 49 war. We don't have to be here for any of that, I'm going to tell y'all, and I'm just going to speak from the heart, because this is the way direct this. I feel like this is the direction God's leading me. Would that be okay? All right. So how many of you remember a year ago anything about 5 red heifers? Let me see your hand. All right. A few of you. Here's the cool thing about that. So when you're reading in Revelation, in the end times, you're reading in the book of Revelation, there's a period where they rebuild the third temple. And when they rebuild the third temple, they rebuild that temple and don't necessarily have to have the outer court, inner court, Holy of Holies. They rebuild this third temple. And if you've read the story, you know that the Antichrist comes and he takes his seat upon that throne of God and declares himself to be the Messiah, himself to be the one. And that atrocity, that's going to happen. That's going to happen. To build that third temple, they need something. They need a few things, in fact. To build that third temple, one of the things that they need, which is one of the critical pieces, 3-4 critical things that they need, one of them is they need a red heifer, talked about in Old Testament. They need a red heifer without spot or blemish that a yoke has never been placed on, and it has to be within its third year. They have to have that for the purification process for the third temple, for any temple. It's been there since the first temple, the second temple. They have to have it for the third temple. I got to hear an interview with the Jew who was over the red on YouTube on Jimmy Evans' A Tipping Point show. He had the guy who was over the Red Heifer Project. Here was the awesome thing. He's looking for red heifers. he's making cold calls to people, to ranchers all over the nation. He happens to get a hold of a guy in the great state of Texas. And he says, hey, I know you don't know me. I don't know you. He said, but we are looking in Israel. We are looking for red heifer. And he goes through. And the guy says, you talking about? And he quotes the scripture. And he goes, you know that scripture? He said, boy, I know that scripture better than you do. He don't know that he's talking to a Levitical priest. And he starts laughing. And he says, do you know of any? He said, I raise red heifers. And I got buddies who raise red heifers. They looked, long story short, they looked. Can't have more, according to him, it can't have more than one white hair or black hair. They have to be red. And they can never have a blemish, which means if they've been ear tagged, it's over. They could never have had a yoke put on them. No blemish, spotless. They called his buddies. Israel sent a team, this fella. They found five in the state of Texas that met all that criteria. Last year, they flew them to Israel from DFW Airport. Might have been, yeah, DFW. They flew them to Israel from DFW. They have them there. So they're in an undisclosed location. They are checking them so far. Three of them still meet that criteria. There'll be three in May. There'll be three in May 2024. Timeline is close. We don't have to be here for that building of the temple. We don't have to be here when they sacrifice this perfect, the one who makes it, sacrifice this perfect red heifer, mix it with the water. In the old days, they believe it was from the Pool of Siloam. They mix it with this water, and they use that for the purification process for that temple. It's close. Another thing they have to have are the utensils. They have them. The other thing they have to have a Levitical priest who met that standard, an Old Testament standard, in order to do the sacrifice, in order to do the purification process. Well, when he went back to Israel, and he was announcing in a forum of Israeli rabbis, one of them said, we already have them. And he said, what? And the other one, I guess they weren't even communicating. He goes, you have the red heifers? He said, we have them. And he said, you have the priest? And he said, we have them. There's seven. They're all teenagers. They range from 13 to 17. They met the Levitical standard to be able to perform their sacrifice. They said, well, all we need, the one over the red heifer project said, now all we need is a tract of land in the Mount of Olives, because the sacrifice has to take place in the Mount of Olives. And he said, my brother-in-law just bought a tract of land that never comes for sale in the Mount of Olives. No one's selling that land. Just bought a piece of land in the Mount of Olives. They have the heifers. They have the priests. They have the utensils. They have the place. Church, it's coming soon. It's coming soon. And we're going to talk about that. What's coming soon? What's coming soon? I believe it's the rapture of the church. I believe the catching away of the saints is coming next. Don't know when. The Bible even says no one knows the day or the hour. Our job is to be ready. Our job is to be prepared so that when that day comes, we are not trying to get ready. We are ready. So I'm going to stand here today with this word that the Lord has led me to share so that when that day comes, you can't say, man, my stinking pastor never told me nothing about that. Oh, yes, your stinking pastor did. And so, yeah. Put some foo-foo on today. And then I was like, all right, Lord, I'm going to go with it. Let me share this story with you. This freaked our family out, but it kind of ties right in to this message. So how many of you got barn cats? Got a barn cat, all right? Man, you them barn cats are worth their weight. Man, they keep we got a tabby, so we had two male tabbies. We don't have a barn, but we do have that. I'm going to tell you that you let your grandkids name them Goose and Gus. And they're both tabby cats, and man, they are assassins. There is not a mockingbird in the yard. There is not a blue jay, a cardinal. There is not a mole, a gopher, a snake, a rat, or a mouse. There is nothing like that. When you walk into our yard, it is nothing but peace. They're crazy good at what they do. And the awesome thing about that is those cats keep peace in our house. What do you think April's number one fear is in this world? Mice. We live in the country. And she knows when she looks out there and they're mowing the field, she knows what's fixing that. What happens when they mow a field? Woo! Man. So these cats are extremely important to our relationship. They're extremely important to the quality of sleep I get at night. So anyway, Danny and Tanya are walking, and they walk every morning up and down the street. They live probably about 200 yards away. They're walking up and down the street out in the country, and they see one of the cats. I'm like, oh, man. And they saw it, and Danny said he even kicked it, and it was the rigor mortis was already setting in. Yeah, and he took a picture, and he sent it, and he said, I think y'all got a dead cat. I'm like, man, that stinks. And, hey, at least we still got one, you know. And I'm just still thinking about peace, and I was kind of sad because the one that's the best with the grandkid is Goose. Gus, he don't want nothing to do with none of y'all. And none of y'all, none of me, none of them. He antisocial. Like, dang, Goose was a sweet one. Anyway, so I go out to look. Man, let me go find him, because my daughters all said, you know, that was a good cat. He was a good cat. He was fierce, but he was so sweet to the grandkids. You need to bury that cat. All right, I'm going to bury him with the dogs. I go looking for this cat. I walk up one side about a half a mile. I come back down the other side about a half a mile. Guess what I don't find? Don't find him nowhere. So I get back to the yard. I'm like, walked in. I said, babe, I can't find that cat. He said, well, Landry said there was some vultures and stuff out there. Maybe they got it. So I called Danny. What side of the road was it on? Go out your yard, take a left. It's on the left. How far? Not very far. I go out and I walk again. Guess what I don't find? No. So I thought, well, maybe. Let's see if I can get the other one to come. I poured up some feed in that metal tin, and I started rattling. Tick, tick, tick. And I set it down and hollered, come on. I figure if it works for cows, it works for cats. Come on. A cat shows up. I said, dang, you know, it's Gus. Oh, dang, oh, Goose. Golly. And so anyway, late about 3 hours later, I go get in the truck. April said, "It's you're not the cook." Y'all know she had a surgery. Then she had an emergency back surgery after the surgery. She's doing great, recovering well. She's starting to get her fight back, sassy as ever. I just stay out of range like that. She can't kick me. And as long as I can bob and weave, I'm good. And so she said, it's you're not the cook. I said, Chick-fil-A, roadkill, roadhouse, what do you want? And so she's like, I can't remember what she named off, but I got in the truck. When I came back, I looked up on the porch swing, and I'm like, that looks like Goose. Now, I'm kind of freaked out. Like, man, this son going to get buried in Pet Cemetery? And, yeah, some of y'all have seen that show. But whoo, whoo. So we walk up there, and it's got one snaggle tooth. And I reached over, and I lifted up that lip, and I'm like, I'd be dang. So I went in, and I told April, I said, guess who's swinging in the porch swing? She said, who? I said, Goose. She said, oh, boo. I said, I'm telling you. So she's like, what? So she calls all the kids, Goose is alive. And I felt like this when I was looking out there looking for Goose. I felt like, why are you looking for that that's alive among the dead? And some of you got that. That's what the angel said to Mary and the other women when they went to see Jesus at the tomb. But I thought about that. Man, that was so weird. I fed Gus, couldn't find Goose. They thought, well, maybe a snake bit it, and it was like it came to. I don't know. I can't explain it. All I know is Goose lives. Goose lives. I got to thinking about the resurrection. I got to thinking about that and about Jesus and about what's next. And so I want to get in a little bit into what could be next would be the catching away. Do you know the word rapture? It's not in the Bible. But caught up or caught away, it is in Thessalonians. It tells a very good telling story depiction of that, and we're gonna get into a little bit. But before I get into that, I got to back up, and I got to talk about where the resurrection all started. So we're going to get into that. And then we're going to get into a bit of the catching away or the rapture of the saints. And then we got a baby dedication at the end. It's going to be a good, good day. Y'all still with me? All right, let's get into it. Why is it so important? Why was it so important that Christ raised from the dead? Why was that so important? Number one, because he said he would. Because he said he would. He said, just like Jonah was in the belly of the whale for, so will the Son of Man be. And he told about it. He said, I'm going to resurrect. Put me in the ground. 3 days later, I'm going to come out. I'm going to come alive. What if he had not done that? What if? Man, that's what we're going to talk about. First point. We can see that Paul talking to the Corinthians in his letter to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15. We're going to start at verse 12, and we're going to go to verse 19. But tell me this. This is Paul speaking. But tell me this. Since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. This is a good point, just word of knowledge, just FYI. The major difference between the Pharisees and the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. They would not, they do not, however, whatsoever, they did not believe, didn't before, don't now believe in the resurrection of the dead. Not Jesus Christ, not nobody. They don't believe in the resurrection of the dead. That's why they're sad, you see. Okay. Thank y'all for hanging in there with me. For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. Verse 14. And if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is what? And your faith is. Verse 15. And we apostles would all be lying about God. For we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. But that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead. And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are what? But verse 19. And if our hope in Christ, if our hope in Christ is only for this life, then we are more to be pitied than anyone else in this world. Just breaking that real quick down, there are six disastrous consequences if Christ is not resurrected. Number one, preaching Christ would be senseless, verse 14. Second, faith in Christ would be useless. Number three, all witnesses and preachers of the resurrection would be liars, verse 15. No one would be redeemed from sin, verse 17. All believers in Christ who died would have perished with no hope for a life beyond. Christians, sixth thing, Christians would be the most miserable people on earth. The disastrous consequences if Christ had not been resurrected from the dead. We get into the heart of the text. 1 Corinthians 15:20 says this.
It says, you got it.
But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, and he is the first of a great harvest for all who have died. The King James Version of that says, he is the first fruits of all who will be resurrected later. That's what I want to talk about today. The first fruits of all those who will be resurrected later. John 14:19 says this. Jesus speaking, soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you will live also. Since I live, you will live also. Let's look at verse 21 through 23. So you see, just as death came into the world through a man, now the resurrection from the dead began through another man. Death came into the world through what man? Adam. Adam. Resurrection from the dead begun through another man, and his name is Jesus. Jesus. Just as everyone dies because we are all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. But there is an order to this resurrection. Christ was raised as the first of the harvest. Again, the first fruits in King James. then all who belong to Christ will be raised when he comes back. That's a promise that we have, church. That's a promise and insight of what's to come when Christ returns. I love that. It said, but there is an order. There is an order to this resurrection. Number one, who goes first? Christ, two of you. Man, heck yeah. So the first one to resurrect is Christ or Jesus. He is the first to resurrect. He went first. I'm going to save that for later. Almost. Because of his resurrection, those who are Christ's will be raised and enter into heaven. This comes in three stages. And that's those who are in Christ will be raised in three stages. And we will not get to all that. And we'll probably get, there's actually a fourth, but the fourth one is not in Christ. And we'll talk about what happens to those folks on another day. Number one, those who have been saved and died from Pentecost to the rapture will be resurrected along with the living saints, will meet Jesus in the air and ascend to heaven. 1 Thessalonians 14, 16 through 17 says this. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who died will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever. Church, there's coming a day. There's coming a day when all these things that we have seen pass away. There's coming a day that no one knows. And I really thought that this past Rosh Hashanah, which is a two-day festival, also called the Day No One Knows, I really thought, man, could this be the year? Could this be the year that Christ returns? But there were so many anticipating that's going to be it. Christ is going to come at a day when no one knows, when you least expect it, when you're not looking for him. That's when he's going to come. That's when he's going to come. That's when he comes back up to verse 16. That's when the archangel Michael steps up and says, gives another the trumpet with the archangel and with the trumpet call of God. The Lord himself comes down from heaven with a commanding shout. The awesome thing about that is that isn't the second return when Christ puts his feet on the earth. That's going to come later in the Battle of Armageddon. That's going to come later. For now, we who are alive, those who are dead, and then those who are alive are caught up in the air together with Christ, that we meet him in the air, that with him we will be forever. And we don't know when that day's coming. We don't know when that hour is going to be. If we did, how many of you, if you knew what day that a thief was going to break into your home, how many of you would be prepared for that song gone whenever he showed up? All of us would. All of us would. Matter of fact, now that we are empty nesters, I had to start using an alarm system because April, she's not just scared of mice. Sometimes she's fearful of noises and bumps in the night. And so we put in an alarm years ago, but we've had a house full for a period. Now we're empty nesters. So she said, you know what? There ain't nobody in the back part of the house. I want you to turn that alarm system on. I said, do you think it still works? And she said, it better. So she got Wi-Fi just to make sure that it'll work even better. And we turned it on. And she got to talking about it so much, she had me freaked out. I went and got my 9mm and I put it beside the bed. And I'm like, let that son of a gun come up in here. Ain't nobody coming, far as we know. But you know what? We're ready if that son of a gun does. It ain't like we can put an alarm system on heaven and say, Lord, when you break through the plane, that alarm's going to go off and I'm going to say, Lord, forgive me for that Friday and Saturday night. Help me, Lord, to make it. And I receive you as my, we won't have time for that. In the twinkling of an eye, at the sound of the last trumpet, when that sounds, there'll be no time to sit down and say, Lord, let me get, there'll be no time for getting ready. No time for getting ready. Matter of fact, we set that alarm. And apparently, we lost connection between the back bedroom window on the left. So here we are. I'm joking. There ain't nobody coming, baby. Set the alarm. There ain't nobody coming. There ain't nobody bit set the alarm. So I set it. Now she's got me thinking. And I lay there, and I was sound asleep. And all of a sudden, I heard back window, "Wah!" And it started screaming. I jumped up. How many of you ever jumped up and tried to stumble through the house from a dead sleep? I looked like a pinball bouncing on a pinball table. Bang off the table, bang off the wall, bang off the refrigerator. I finally made it in there, hit the code, and it shut off. I was trying to do this. But man, that sucker's loud. Now my heart's racing. Whoo, done forgot my pistol. Like, I make it through the bedroom, and I flip on the light, and I'm looking. And I'm thinking, you need to check the closet. Checking that dang closet. I ain't checking no closet. I go to the back bedroom. I'm like, oh, flip. I started to go back and get my pistol, but I didn't. Jesus, drop them dead, Lord. I flipped it on. I looked. I didn't find nothing but an empty room. And I went over and I opened up the window. I'm like, don't let no booger be standing. There ain't nothing worse than you look outside and you see somebody looking back at you. I peeked it. Nothing. So it was for nothing. My point is, we can't put an alarm system on when Jesus is going to come back. We're not going to get, you know what our warning is? Our warning is not a system that we put in place other than the system of the Word of God. This is what we put in place to ensure that when that day comes, we're ready. We're ready for that day. And when we get this Word applied to our life, when we get Jesus, when we receive Jesus as our Savior, believe that He is the Son of God, lived a sinless life, died, rose again on the third day. When we have those things in place, and now I have a relationship with Christ because I have received Him as my Savior, and now I'm working through the process of sanctification on the way to glorification. Through the process of sanctification, church, you're not going to get it right. You won't. You won't. I wish we were just, bam, perfect. As soon as we received Christ as our Savior, we never sinned another thing and everything went our way. It doesn't work like that. And some of you may be here today and you're thinking, man, I've sure messed up a lot. But I know Christ is my Savior. He's still your Savior. He's still your Savior today. Repent from those things. Change your mind about those things. Come to Christ. Ask for forgiveness. Renew that fellowship with Him. And it can't be a one-sided conversation. We got to do some of the talking. We got to do some of the praying. We got to do some of the walking out our salvation. Walk out that salvation. We got to be ready. We got to be prepared. We can't wait to get ready. We can't wait till the battle comes to get ready for the fight. We have to be prepared. So when the battle comes, we take the fight to that Son of God. We got to make sure that we're in position to stand on the solid rock of Jesus Christ, because without Him, we're going to stumble and we're going to fall. We're not going to make it. We're going to sink in the sand. But when we stand on the solid rock, we not only grow our relationship with Him, we're prepared to meet Him. I've used this analogy, but not all of you, it's not just an analogy, but this verse, and not all of you have heard it. Most of you have. That on the parable of the ten virgins, I keep thinking about this over and over and over. Of the parable of the ten virgins, all ten were what? Virgins. All ten were virgins. If that relates to the church, if that relates to the church, it says that the bridegroom came when they least expected, and all ten got up and they trimmed their lamps. But only five had enough oil to make it. And they went in with the bridegroom and the door was shut. And the other five said, "Give us some of your oil so that we can get there too." And they said, "I don't have enough for me and you. I only have enough for me." And they made it. But the five that didn't have enough, it says that they came and they knocked on the door. And Jesus said, "Depart from me. I never knew you. I never knew you. I never had an intimate relationship with you. Oh, I knew about you. I knew of you. Just like you knew about me. And you knew of me. But we didn't have an intimate relationship." If that represents the church, then 50% are not going to make it just because they go to church. Just because we go to church, doesn't mean that we're ready to meet the Lord should he come today. That's sad. If I could encourage you, matter of fact, it's less than 50%, which we talked about this before. 46% of Americans, of church-going Americans today, only 46% still believe in the major tenets of faith. You know what the one thing that they say they don't believe in anymore, according to the Bible? You know what the one thing they say they don't believe in anymore is that Jesus is not the only way to heaven. Jesus is the only way we're going to make it. Jesus is the only way that we're going to make it through this life. He's the only way that we're going to make it through this day. He's the only way to guarantee that we are in position to meet him when he comes. If they don't believe that he's the way, then that means that means 54% of church-going Americans are trying to seek entrance into heaven without Jesus Christ. That's sad. Now you see how that story that Jesus told in the Bible, what if it's like that worldwide? Now you see how that story that Jesus told of the 10 virgins, now you see how it marries up with where we are mathematically today. Less than 50% are not going to make it. Church, I don't want 50% of this church to not be there. I'm going to be looking too. Man, if you want to know where I am, you'd be looking for me. I'd be riding too. Be riding right. I'd be trying to cut my way up there, get close to him as I can. Here's what I want. Challenge you this week. I want you to check your heart. I want you to check your life. I want you to ask yourself, if Christ were to come back today, would I be ready? And if the answer is, well, I hope so. I wouldn't base my eternity on a hope. I hope so. You need to know so. And if you come to the conclusion that, man, I hope so, or I don't know, you need to know. You need to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. You need to come to the place where you acknowledge that he is the Son of the living God, believe it, receive it, and know that he is your Savior. Know that you are prepared should that day come. So I want you to look. Now, I don't want you to think, well, do I still sin? We all still sin, except for April. But the rest of us, we still sin. One time she did. She jaywalked and spit gum out on the sidewalk. That's about the gist of her. But the rest of us, yes, we still sin. But we have an advocate with the Father, and his name is Jesus Christ. Don't let that wreck your whole life, wreck you to the point that, you know what? Well, I can't do it, so I'll just quit. No, no. Don't do that. Examine your life this week. Think about these words. It's going to come like a thief in the night. The catching away of the saints is going to come like a thief in the night when you least expect it, at the last trumpet. The dead in Christ will rise, and then all we who are alive will raise with him. Here's the great thing about that. When Paul wrote that, Paul was writing in the first person. Then we who were alive, he was waiting. They were expecting, he was expecting right then in his lifetime that Christ would return. That was the second thing that the 56%, 54% did not agree on. They do not believe that Christ will come in their lifetime. Therefore, they are not prepared, and they do not believe that Christ is the only way to heaven. How sad that they go to church and don't know that. I pray that their pastor is preaching the Word of God. I pray that their pastor is teaching the infallible truth of the Word of God. That's the only thing that grows our faith. It comes by hearing by the Word. That's how we make it. If you ain't been in this Word, I want to encourage you to get in this Word. Get in this Word. If you need prayer for anything after, we're going to go ahead and do a baby dedication. And if you need prayer for anything when we're done, please come up and let us pray with you. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, man, let me introduce you to a man who loves you like you are and just like you are. Let me introduce you to a man that'll change your life forever, forever. All right, Robertson Bunch, y'all come on. Tell this one right here. How are you, buddy? You coming over by me? You come on up here if you want. Yeah. Me and Christian going to be over here. This is Kinsley Faye Robertson. Yeah, look at this. Oh, man. Look at that right there. Oh, yeah. Dylan and Bethany wanted to dedicate their baby, little Kinsley, today. They wanted to do it last week, and it didn't work out. This week worked out better. Sleepy. That's what most people do when I preach. You're not alone. And it worked out better this week. Here's the awesome thing about that is, Dylan and Bethany. Here's the cool thing about that. So the story in the Bible in Mark, it says that Jesus was there and his disciples were there at a place and some parents brought their children to see Jesus. And the children ran to Jesus and they crawled up in his lap. And I know if they're like my grandkids, they're crawling on him and around him and pulling his beard and he's laughing and playing and he's holding on to them. And the disciples got upset and they said, man, get them kids away from the master. And he said, don't get them kids away from the master. Unless you come like these kids, you'll not inherit the kingdom of God. I love that story. But what it shows is that you came to dedicate Kinsley here today to God. But what it really is, it's you saying before all these people that you commit to raise her in a godly home, that you commit to teach her biblical values and principles that are going to be the foundation of her life. Awesome thing about that story, about that event with Jesus that day, is the cool thing about today is you brought Kinsley to church. You brought Kinsley and put her in position to receive seed of the gospel of Jesus that'll help be the foundation, that help be the foundation of her life. The other thing about that is in Paul's letter to the Corinthians, he says that the Holy Spirit gives a gift to every single one of us as a means of helping the entire body. I pray that as a little Kinsley grows up and these other little kids grow up, that you seek the Lord for the gift that God has given you and that God has given your kids and help them to be all that God has created them to be. I know that we can't do that alone. What we just talked about earlier was the infallible truth of the Word of God. This is the foundation. This is the rock. The Word of God is the rock that we raise our families on, the rock that we stand on as dads, as moms. And we can't do this alone. Even together, it's difficult. But when you do it with Jesus in the mix, when you seek Him, lean on Him, study Him, teach your children about Him, that's when your family becomes strong. That's what it means to build your house on the solid rock. So standing here today, Dylan and Bethany, do you pledge to bring your child to Jesus? Do you pledge to raise your children in biblical principles according to the Word of God? And to seek the Lord concerning the gift that the Holy Spirit has given you and them, and to walk in that gift and to help them do the same. I know that as a church body that we commit to be with you, to stand with you, to help you, to support you, and to be here if you have questions. We're not here to tell you what you ought to do is, or you're doing this wrong, or you're not doing it right. What we're here to do is to support and to love and to help you all the way through this process. Amen, church? Amen. I'm going to pray for you. Father God, we thank you. We praise you for Dylan, for Bethany. We thank you for these boys that are wandering off. We thank you, Lord, for Kinsley. We thank you, Father, for this awesome family. I thank you, Lord, for their willingness to come and to dedicate their little baby to you. And I thank you, Lord, that you help them to be the parents that you've created them to be. By doing that, he is the man. Dylan is the man you created him to be. Bethany is the woman you created her to be. And they're seeking you for guidance to raise their kids, to live their life according to your biblical principles. God, we love you. We thank you. And we pray, Lord, that you help them. Help them, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Y'all need a picture. You got your camera?